I presume people, it's 10 o'clock in the morning, so people will be wandering in and out, bleary-eyed. Who knows how they'd be thinking? So I'm guessing, looking around, that we're going to be talking today about cinema and millennials. And I'm guessing at this stage, there's not all that many millennials in here. And if I got you wrong, I apologise. It's very dark out there, so I can't entirely tell. I think there's a kind of irony, that, and it will kind of come through. There's so much of this Cannes this year has been talking about diversity, but it is one where I think in lots of ways, if you walk down the Rue d'Antibes, I went to a discussionist about ethnic minorities and filmmaking, and walking down the Rue d'Antibes, I couldn't help but notice every single one of those pictures over the Rue d'Antibes. There's not a single black face on them. This is the town where we're talking lots about women in film at the moment, but you have to wear high heels to get into screening. So equally, I think there is an issue about younger people, and that's before we get on to the issues of class, which I think we have problems with anyway. But I think what we've got in the audience here, which is why I think it's so important we talk about these in next, is that there are people on the stage here, the cinemas, are still the places that have to get people in. So it isn't something where you ever get the luxury as cinemas of talking about things in the abstract. You can't talk about cinema, about audiences, as if they were some kind of strange beast that we don't have to come across. You have to take the money. You have to actually have them in your cinemas. So what we're going to be talking about today is really about how a generation that hasn't necessarily grown up with cinema in the way that most of the people in this room will have grown up with cinema, how do we create the culture in which they will come along? So as a quick introduction, the panel are going to introduce themselves in a moment. And this is an event sponsored by Europa Cinemas, which has been doing a lot of work around getting young people into cinemas. It's a big part of the subsidy they work. I'm Michael Gubbins. I'm the I run my own kind of agency, which works on looking at the way that audiences interact with film, including young audiences. And I chair a film fund, and I'm the former editor of Screen International, and so on. I wanted, just before we start, before we introduce ourselves, just to get exactly the topic we're talking about here. Millennials. Anyone? When do we think millennials were born? What do we think the earliest date for millennials? Let's have a shout out. What do you think a millennial is? No idea? 1990? We're going to go with 1990. Apparently it was 1982. It was people who were... But of course, people who were born in 1982, they're old people now. We don't really care about what they think. So 1990, I think what we're really talking about is the age, the under 25s age, I think, where you are actually in control with the decision of what films you watch. So when we talk about young people in film, children, when my children were children, they went to whatever I damn well told them they went to. But now they're at an age where they don't think that way anymore. And just for this one conference, I decided as a personal contribution to have two children, 15 and 18 years ago, to kind of help the discussion. So I have my own personal piece of research. But I just want to give you a very brief summary of all the research that there is out there. And to say, first of all, when we're looking at how do we get young people into cinemas, the research is hopeless. It's inadequate. It's lazy. It's weak. And I think that so much when we're talking about the art house world, or when we're talking about the kind of... I mean, even the word art house is already problematic, but the kind of films we're going to be seeing in Cannes, a great many of the great films we're going to see here... would at one time have connected with a much younger audience than they are now. And we need to ask ourselves how we can get some of this great film into the kind of orbit of people who are younger. So I'm going to give you the full reason, but basically that's what we're going to be talking about today. If I could wrap up, my daughter uses this phrase still, it's quite old hat now, of duh, and duh means... That's so obvious. Why are you even asking that question? So the duh reasons why young people aren't going to the cinema from all of the research collected elsewhere are, first of all, and again, I have to quote my son here, we've got shit to do. What they mean is when most of us in the room, if you are in your 40s plus here, when you were a child or when you were young, you had nothing to do with your life. There were probably two channels of television, maybe three channels of television in some countries. Normally when I say that, someone comes up and says, you're lucky, we had one channel of TV, but you were introduced to film through television. We are competing in a world in which there is so much more that you can do. All of that television, all of that gaming, all of the just the straightforward social media behaviors that I think mean that you've got to be on the grid all the time. So number one is there's loads of other things to do. We've got to compete in that world. Number two is price, always comes up. The problem we have, again, it's a discussion that will come up here, is that the research, there's a great piece of research done about in America about what is the what do young people consider to be a fair price, teenagers. The fair price of a film for teenagers was zero, nothing. We get it for free. It's not even a discussion. I can watch it any time for free. The interesting other bit of that research, which was now 10 years ago, was at the time there was these new things called ringtones on your phones, and they said, I'd pay nothing for music. The fair price for music is nothing, but I'd spend $3 on a ringtone. Because the idea was that it was personalized. It was something that said something about them. So one of the things we're going to be talking about a lot today is the experiential. I think that one of the dangers that we're having in the conversation, and we'll discuss this, is that the research does not suggest that everyone wants to have their mobile phones on when they're watching films in cinemas. The problem we have is that they want to be on the mobile phones and therefore don't go to the cinema necessarily. But when they're in the cinema, you don't want to make the cinema more like the rest of their experience. You want to make it less like. You want to make it different. All of the research, there's a lot of research around sport, which was very similar, which was there was an assumption that no one would watch live sport anymore when it was on TV. And what live sport realized after a while is actually they will. They're more likely. So you make the experience different, which is why when I was talking on a panel with the European Audiovisual Observatory, my old pal Ted Hope, who's now the head of Amazon's production, saying, of course, we're going to do our films that we produce for Amazon in cinemas. Of course we are, because that's the experiential element of it. That's the bit where we can get people excited and interested, and VOD will get the benefits from it. So a unique experience. And I think what we're going to talk about here when we're going through is the idea that that might even be seen more as an event. Maybe we should be playing that even more. We'll see what the panel thinks. But the research tells me from all the work we've done that the experience has to be brilliant in order for them to be willing to come off the kind of basic stuff. So we've got our experience and price and lots of other stuff to do, all kind of fitting in together. Then the last bit is simple. And it kind of fits in with the first bit, which is time. The time that you're willing to commit means that you are off the always-on grid. When you are, this is all the young people that we're answering saying, and I don't know how many of you here have got children. If you've got teenage children, you'll know that social media is no longer. That's not. A supplement to life, that's part of your life. You're talking all the time. You are constantly interacting. There's a dialogue going on. For some types, because again, I think it's we've got to be very careful here. We don't try and make out there's one group called young people that are all the same. But it's really essential that we understand when we're talking about innovation and new ways of doing it, that we are trying to work out how we can make that time become more justified. And I think one of the things we're going to hear about here is cinemas are social spaces. Cinemas have got lots of other things you can do with them. It's not just you come in, you buy your popcorn, and you watch the film. Increasingly, the cinemas and the ones on this panel here are looking at how you build that into multimedia events, how you bring in music, how you create that as part of their culture, how we integrate film into that culture. So what we're going to talk about today, and I want this to be do with the interactive side from yourselves, just shout if you think something's interesting or needs expanding. You put your hand up, and if you can't be bothered to hand up, throw something. If you think something's bullshit, this is the most important stuff that we're going to talk about. We can talk about Next all we want, but the reason we're having this conference now about Next with Europa Cinemas in Cannes is because we've suddenly realized that cinemas aren't anymore being seen as the past. That's not the old world to be replaced by the new world. The experiential is what is going to make these films that are up on those big screens actually relevant to anybody. So what we're really talking about, how do we make experiences? How do we make events? How do we create a culture in which young people feel invested? And the very last thing I mentioned on all of the research, because that's you may have read bits here and there, is I think that we need to start listening. And I think that one of the things that we will talk about on this panel here is what can we do for young people is exactly the same with discussion that I'm criticizing about a lot of the diversity discussion. What can we do for people from poorer communities? What can we do for people from ethnic backgrounds? It doesn't alter my power base. I am still the arbiter. I should decide. It's time we start using these instead of this. And I think that that's a really big problem. If you want to know why young people and how we're going to get them involved, start talking. And then you'll realize most people in this room, it's statistically true that in most rooms of people, most of them used to be young people at one time. Not everyone. I think particularly in France, I think you can go to places where people quite clearly were never. They were born art house fans at the age of 25. But there are people now where I think we've got to learn how to have that dialogue. And we're going to talk quite a bit about all these themes and take them apart during this session. So that's all the research. That's the background. Everyone get that? Anyone not get that? Good. Okay. I'm going to ask the panel to introduce themselves first. We've got a very distinguished group. We're going to go left to right. And then what we're going to do is we're going to have themes which I'm going to make clear to you, and your opinions will be welcome. But first of all...
Hello. Welcome. I'm Graeme Eber from the Netherlands, and I'm the director of cinema and art house with 5 screens and a beautiful concert hall in a brand new building. It's now for 5 years. Lantern Fenster was an old cinema from the 70s, and it moved in 2010 to a new place at the river in Rotterdam, the Maas. And so we're talking about young audience. Well, I'm also talking about a young cinema. And with this new cinema, we also have the possibility to attract a more large scale of people. Well, I know you're all very visual, so I have a promotion trailer for you to show.
Yep, yep, y'all ready for this? Hey, y'all ready, fellas?
Ein Ebbeck, isn't it? from other panels and Europa Cinema Conference, I do realize that we're in Holland in a rather luxury situation, that we are supported by the local government to build new venues, and new venues also in combination with theater or music. As you can see on this trailer, Rotterdam, well, probably you have been to the International Film Festival, Rotterdam is a young and dynamic city. I mean, young, that a lot of young people live there. We really do realize it's really tough to get the younger audience to the cinema, not to the concert, that's maybe easier. To be honest, I can understand it very well. If I also have kids, and if you look what's available in the whole week for going out in Rotterdam, it's immense. It's tough to make your choices when you're young. So I do realize film and concert are just one of the few choices you can make. What's important for us is maybe they won't come, but we want them to be informed. We want them to know where the cinema is. So at a certain moment that they will come, and maybe it can take some time and they have young kids and careers before they come when they're 35 or 40 back to the cinema. But anyway, they have to be informed. I said luxury because, but that doesn't mean we don't have to a lot of effort also to gain enough visitors. It doesn't mean we have a restaurant. It does mean we have to rent our place for seminars and other things. We get 30% support from the government. I always call it not a support, but an investment from the government, because an art house like us is a very good spot for the city. It makes a city attractive. It makes a reason to live there. It means a reason for young people to study. So I think I think they got a rather cheap price for it. Well, that's you can see in the brochure what's at the door, a small story about our cinema. So I don't have to repeat at all. And of course, all the questions are very, very welcome.
Thank you. I'm Alison Gardner. I am the Programme Director of Glasgow Film and the Co-Director of Glasgow Film Festival in Scotland. I have the exact opposite building. I have one of the oldest cinemas in the UK, built in 1939. There's a lovely picture of it here, Art Deco building, three screens and various festivals. Young people, difficult question. I think that we'll get a lot of answers here, and I am also keen to hear back from you, the audience, what you think, and give us your feedback and experiences as well. So thank you.
Hi, I'm Michel Ferry. I run and own a theater in Orléans, which actually was built in the 50s after the war, because big part of the city was bombed and didn't exist anymore. It's a hard house theater. We have three screens, 130,000 audience every year. We do a lot of work with schools for an amount of 30,000 spectators every year. I think one of the questions is, what is it that we do for the youth in general, in any domain? Not much. So, I mean, for example, in France, the government, Hollande, one of his big thing in the when he ran for president was to say that he was going to do something for the youth. So much, I don't know, he's got another year left, but I haven't seen much done. I think one of the issues, to get straight into the debate, if I may, is the ones who do something truly aimed at teenagers or a younger audience are the Americans. They do blockbusters aimed at that, marketed for that. what we found out reaching out at younger audiences, there were two main issues that came out. The price issue. They don't know that it's actually cheap to go in an art house theater, cheaper than going in a multiplex. Second, once you tell them about the films you're showing, they're interested in the films. The problem is they never hear about those films because those films are marketed for the audience that exists already in the art house, which are often aging audience. And you wonders why distributors don't try to reach that audience also. I mean, the market is huge.
Then you between you all, and thanks very much for your intros, you can see different types of cinemas, different kind of backgrounds. I think we're exposing a whole lot of the kind of key questions. I'm going to put them down into three sections, though. That first bit that you pointed out last was how do we expose people to film in the first place, that marketing thing. And I think this is an important change that's happened, which is when you were younger, the art house film was on, I don't want to use this term art house, film, European film, the kind of films that we're seeing in Cannes, the non-American blockbuster films, you would see them on television. You don't see them on television anymore. There's been a fragmentation of the audience, and the fragmentation it exists within young people as well. Young people are not the same. My son is into art house film, not because I pushed him, but because it's part of the culture and his mates. My daughter has got a great line where she just says, oh, it's twice as long and twice as boring. That's her her view of anything her dad likes, which is a really key thing, must be boring, almost by definition. So how do we expose, how do we market will be the first bit. How do we get into the consciousness of those younger audiences is quite a big deal. The second, I think, is content, which I didn't discuss before as one of the key things that people discuss, because we almost don't know how to discuss it. If people don't know what you mean by the kind of films, we keep using this word here, this is quality, as opposed to what? As opposed to, we talk about mainstream and art house. What do we mean by those terms? They're actually pretty dangerous if you're trying to introduce people to something, because it's almost saying, you'll probably hate this, because it's not the stuff that that people like in general. We're not going through that process anymore that I think we went through of being introduced slowly and working your way through and finding your own way to kind of intelligent film. So how do we make that happen? So that first bit is going to be about how do we create awareness and that can turn into engagement. The second one will be about content, which is going to be about the nature of the films. Do we write off younger audiences as being... I hear it all the time here. Young people, they like robots fighting and they like 3D. And says who? Says what? How have we written off a generation? And I just want to make one really small point here. This is a demographic thing. The statistics, the last of reports I saw of an art house cinema between 2012 in the UK, 2012 and 2015, young audiences dropped by 20% for independent cinemas. But actually, we're all getting older. That's the age population. One of the reasons might be that actually the power now is in the hands of older people. The average age in Germany will be 50 in a couple of years' time. When I was a young kid, it was in the 30s. So we all went when we were in our 20s, I suspect, to art house cinema. We just didn't stop going. And now, how much of that power is in the hands? How much do we define what the content is that we expect them to enjoy? How much are we creating experiences for us that we're saying, oh, we'll let them in if they're well-behaved? That seems to me quite an important element. And the third part of it will be about the experience itself, which is how do we create experiences and events and ideas that actually people can buy into. So exposure and awareness, content and experience. That sound fair? Okay, well, let's start with the exposure side of things. I wonder, first of all, from a maybe we could start with you, Alison. It seems to me there is a problem now that when younger people know about films, they're actually more knowledgeable than we used to be because they've got the internet in lots of ways. I just wonder how, for you, when you're looking at a younger audience, I just wonder, from a marketing perspective, what's changed? What is it you're noticing that's different from when we were younger?
Well, we started about 12 years ago this process, we realised our audience was getting really old and we thought we better do something about it. Part of our initial problem was that people thought we showed old movies, dirty movies, French movies, which in some cases were the same thing. Staying vertical, anyone? So we decided that we would look to see what we could do. We wanted to get people through the door. We wanted to ensure that these people were young people and families so that they felt that there was no barriers to them coming. So we created a program called Take Two, which is free movies for free for the young person and free for their parent. So there's no cost at all. We obviously pay the distributors for the film, but there is no cost to the audience at all. And that began to bring us huge numbers of families. Poorer families, Glasgow, for those of you who don't know, while it's a very vibrantly culturally aware city, has a huge levels of poverty still, probably one of the biggest in the UK, unfortunately. So we have a lot of poor people on our doorstep, and we are a city centre cinema. So we noticed that these were a different demographic. They came, we would show them, I don't know, Minions or something to entice them in 1 week. But then the next time we would show them Belle and Sebastian, a subtitled film. The numbers didn't drop at all. So these audiences, these family audiences, were coming, getting used to the building, and they just put it into part of their regular program. And because it was free and they didn't have much money, they would bring all their own sweeties, so we didn't make any money. So it was a really great way to have a diverse and interesting audience through our door. We have noticed in that 12-year period that those young people who came as families have now migrated onto the Glasgow Youth Film Festival. And also into another program that we have called Pop-Up Programmers, and then into the main film festival itself, and they've become GFT regulars. So we have noticed in that period a shift in our demographic, which is really what we decided that audience development initiative was for.
So in terms of just to, because there's a hell of a lot in there that you've been doing, but it seems like you've recognised all these issues around price and around the lack of attraction. I just think, I think your argument is you expose them to the cinema first, rather than thinking that your task is necessarily to introduce them to the kind of films that you show. If you can get people interested in seeing the space, I do wonder, again, we're getting into the content bit here, but I wonder whether actually with the Youth Film Festival and so on, the sense that we think here that a film is quality and no one will like it, I wonder whether people would notice the difference. You know, you go and watch a really well-done American indie and then you go to a really good European. I just wonder whether that's part of our job is to get rid of the kind of mythologizing about this is quality for us and that's rubbish for them.
You've got to make it accessible and you've also got to know... you can't group all young people into the same. I think that was a really important point that we said, because we have a lot of people who won't come into the city centre for various reasons. Gang issues, for example, bus fares. There's a lot of problems that we had to, that when we spoke to a lot of young people to try and find out through our school's work, why don't you come to the GFT? What is it you don't like about it? Tell us, etc. So with the Youth Film Festival, which was in its ninth year, it's a film festival curated entirely by young people who we mentor for a year. They can apply to come in. We actually go to schools with social economic problems. We go into those schools and we actively seek those youngsters who are interested in film but don't think they can do a film festival. They don't think they're smart enough. And we mentor them, a group of 20, for a year, and then they put on the film festival and they choose the films. Because it's not a case of just build it or put it on and they will come. Would that it were so simple, to quote some films there. It's just that is not the case for most people. You have to listen and hear what it is that they want to see. And so the Youth Film Festival has a variety of films, American, Dutch, French, German, films that they have curated themselves throughout the year. And then they also do peer-to-peer marketing, and that makes a much more effective tool. And they use different tools than we would use to market the main festival, for example.
Right, let me just quickly also see whether the Rotterdam experience is the same. But just to be clear here, you actually go, you do the asking. I mean, when you know that there's a disconnection. One of the things that I think is missing in the industry more widely is, well, you can find these things out. You can actually go into those communities and find them. Then you're taking people from those communities and saying, look, we want an active involvement here. That's we don't just want you to sit down as a passive audience here. There's a possibility that if you are involved in the programming of the films, you're going to feel much more of a commitment to that sense. That's
So that's true, but also we took it a step further. We also have somebody from the Youth Film Festival who's come through that process, who's now on our board of trustees. Because you have to really, you can't just talk the talk, you have to walk your walk. You have to say, if we are committed to young people, then we have to have somebody who's represented on the board. Obviously this person's 18, but they came through that process, through the Youth Film Festival, through the pop-up programmers. Just a little bit about pop-up programmers. That was a program where we took young people from very deprived areas and trained them how to put on cinema events in their own community, not at our cinema. And they could choose the films, but it was really about engaging with cinema as a whole. And so that was a really interesting project that threw up a lot of great and difficult points, I have to say.
So you go to them, which is really
Yeah, we take the cinema experience to them.
Well, first about the content, I think the content really changed in these days. The old art house cinema had limited content, and I think in the Netherlands anyway, most cinemas have completely different content in a way. For example, our cinema has 400 special screenings, 5 to 6 international festivals in the year. So that does mean it does attract a lot of other people, not the regular art house people. You have an education part. That does mean your art house is available for classes to visit. But maybe that's even the most important thing. There is an enormous demand for presentation from schools when they have a special project and want to show it, presentations for all kinds of groups. And, well, if the finance allows us, we try to be an open house for them. And so anyway, they know where our cinema is. They have been in our cinema. I'm not going to change my programming because I want to attract younger people, because I think you need a profile on theater and you make a choice for a kind of programming. But what you see nowadays often too is that there is a lot of interest, for example, in documentaries on special issues, social issues, and that attracts also a lot of people. Of course, it's not a regular documentary for 3 weeks in the cinema every evening, but 2 or 3 screenings, often very well packed. And then you need, and then you can use, and that's what we do as well, the social media very well. Because they're interesting when it's about new food developments, all kinds of new social developments in the world. They're really interested, and then you can use the social media very well to get them to your cinema, to your events.
You're coming from the content angle here, which is really good. I'm glad you've mentioned social media, because that seems to me the new forms of marketing are really important, because this is the point. You need to ask people. You need to get into the conversations that are already going on, is the point. I just wonder how you know when you're making your programming decisions. We saw in Glasgow, which still runs basically the core program is the same, but what I think Alice is saying is that there is room for actually asking what they would like to see, what they think, how they would react, particularly if the cinema's going out to their own areas. Are you suggesting that that's not the main thing? The main thing is actually getting into their conversations and having confidence in your own the program that you're already running.
Well, the problem with social media, we're not the only one who tries to find them on the social media, but it does mean that, and you cannot do it with every film, but you cannot do it with some films or some projects, that you really focus on the group you want to reach. And then social media is a very important issue. We know, and we really know by the box office, the tickets, we can see if we will reach them, because we see on online that the selling of tickets is improving. So with Google Awards and other possibilities. But we do realize we're not the only one. Everyone is chasing with the social media about the audience to get them in. But it's for us, 95% is social media. We hardly use any other classic promotion anymore.
Michelle's going to come in. But social media, when people say they use social media, the use of social media has changed very much. Facebook, it seems to me, with my daughter, for example, Facebook is the social media that she wants me to think they use all the time, because that's where she knows I follow her on that page. But, you know, for her, it's Snapchat and Instagram and various other things, particularly Snapchat, actually, and FaceTime and lots of these different things. When you talk about social media, it seems to me a lot of organizations, and this is true of distributors as well, is you stick up a Facebook page and a YouTube video, and you think you have a few tweets, and you think you've done your job in social media. But I wonder how sophisticated your social media use is.
Well, you start with having marketing people who are young, who know their audience. And I agree, there is an enormous development in social media. That doesn't mean that Facebook is out and Instagram is only in. But it's you should really think about when you start your campaign, how to start a campaign, and try to focus on your group. And indeed, try to. We have several volunteer groups of people who are involved in our cinema, and that helps as well, because all the volunteers have also their own group. So there is not a receipt for how to reach them, but just don't use the usual things. But some things work better than others. So you really focus on how to have your campaign, and that's the same as before.
Okay, just to sum up, I think what you've got here is the same discussion, which is, rather than what can we do for younger audiences, we're actually saying, look, the best way of doing it is to actually get them involved in, for you, the programming, if you're going to do social media, don't try and do it yourself like dad dancing, you know, do it your...
I mean, what we decided was that we would go to those groups that they found interesting and get them to do the social media on the films, because, say, for example, around Mustang, we worked with a lot of young women's groups, and we worked with a lot of feminist groups, and they spoke to their people on our behalf and said, you have to go and see Mustang at Glasgow Film, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So using other people, and it's time-consuming... to do it yourself, but if you speak to the right groups and you engage those groups all year round, then they'll do the work for you.
Okay, sure.
One of the things we never seem to put into the question is, we're in Orléans, for example, we open at 9 in the morning, we close at midnight. From 9 to 11, basically, we have the schools, high school, colleges, and so on. From 11 on until midnight, we have the, quote, regular audience. How many people are available during the day? I mean, people are either studying, and for example, in Orléans, the high schools, the university is outside the city, it's 45 minutes, so they don't have time to come. In Paris, the student audience just walks from the university to the theater. So they're not available during the day. For example, in our case, we discovered that we had a great opening with the later screenings, 9:30 and so on. And mathematically, I think we're bound to have an older audience, because there are retired people who have more time to come during the day. So basically, it's hard to get the younger during the day. The entire French, all the French theaters tried a couple of years ago. I mean, 2 years ago, 3 years ago, started that thing where everybody who was under 14 would only pay €4 to watch a film. The amount of audience grew very much in multiplexes and very much for blockbusters. Let's face it, it didn't change anything for art house, because we were already under €4. So we don't, in Orléans, for example, we don't try the we tried several things. We tried to do screenings for parents, but we got them to pay still, because we otherwise we fear that they get into the thing is that our theater is a theater where you go for free, and the theater where you go to pay is a multiplex, which is, you know, 500 meters away. Which is, you know, there is a strange logic where people think it's expensive because the prices of the multiplexes are expensive compared to ours. And I think we need to wonder why people are more aware of the prices of the multiplexes than our prices, and why when we get the audience, when we talk to the younger kids who come in the morning from the with the school screening, why is they still think the multiplex is the real film theater as opposed to ours being something weird? We tried getting them to choose films, and we had a great surprise. We actually listed a couple of films. We didn't want them to choose out of the blue, but we listed a certain amount of film, among which we had Midnight Special, the Jeff Nichols films. We had Girlhood. We had Watchda, and several films. I was convinced they would choose Midnight Special. You know, it had just been released. Was not doing so well, but it had just been. The trailer was great. Oh, we thought they'd choose Girlhood. They went for Watchda. And we filled the theater. So I think we still have great surprises to come on what they're interested in. And I do agree that we still need to editorialize our thing, and but get them to know what we're showing. And as for the social media, I mean, we're a very small team in the theater. We're five of us, so we don't have much time to do much. It's true that we tended to believe that we create a Facebook and that's it. It's done. But it doesn't work this way. It's true that they're much more on Snapchat. Snapchat? Yeah. Yeah. That tells you how much aware I am. But what proves the most efficient so far for us is in the... We had a price rate for under 26. We've had it for 3 years, and we only got them to know that it was that price when we organized a festival that was aimed at people under 26. The first screening, the attendance was terrible, and the last screening, the attendance was great, and it was actually Blade Runner. And it proved great because it could come with their parents, and it was certainly an experience they could share that was transgeneration.
Yeah, we're going to come to some more of these things on Conto. I just want to sum up this because I think it was a point to be made at the front. We're just getting over a couple of areas here. One is, how do we get into the conversation? That seems to me critical. I think the point I would make is that the conversation that we need to get into ought to be a lot earlier than to me, it's not just about distributors. I mean, I chair the Film Cymru Wales, which is the Welsh Film Board, and one of the things we do there is we make producers right at the beginning of their campaign start thinking about audience relationships. They ought to be thinking about an audience strategy, and they ought to take responsibility for seeing those things through, because there is a point that when it gets to the cinema, you have got a tiny window of opportunity here to actually get through. But getting into their conversation and their lifestyle, it seems to me, I think it's a really important point, Michelle. I think that idea that the programming is the programming that we've always done, but actually it's not necessarily the pattern of the way that people expect and want to watch things these days. I don't think cinema programming has changed in terms of times, ever. I can't remember in my lifetime there would be a screening at the right kind of time. And quite often, if you think about how often in your life you've ticked things where I really wanted to go and see that, but it started 10 minutes earlier. I think from the research that we've been doing, there's a lot less patience for that kind of thing than we had, because there wasn't a lot else to do. You don't get them in your 10 minutes. There's a million of other things that they could, that people that could be in, including things that are directly on the mobile phone for them outside the cinema where they're watching it. So that kind of strategy seems to me good. I think the social media side of it still feels to me, as I say, it can be amateurish, and I still think we're all trying to learn about social media. But I do take the point that getting younger people themselves, it's not you telling them. What you want is to be in their conversations they're having with other people, and that seems to me not a top-down thing. You've actually got to work out the kind of messages, which is what we're going to come to as we go on, is what are the messages that work. So conversation lifestyle, did you want to make a point?
Okay, Christopher Buckles. I direct a big Francophone film festival in Germany, so I have all the same problems. And I'm interested in which social media and how you do it, because today you supposedly we can communicate on end, and nobody's really looking at anything. I mean, I was surprised because we have young people that work with us, and they said, look, they know the poster of the festival. They don't know what's going on in the festival. I said, "What? We have we have Facebook, but we have online. All the information is out there. The program is for free. It's handed out. I mean, everything's there. They still don't know. So they're either not. Young people are not interested today. I think they're used to getting fed things on a silver platter. So I'm very interested. What kind of social media? Because I've even heard people say, make a poster for each event and hang it out in the university and everywhere, and then they might get it. So that's pretty scary, because we can't, you can't afford to do a poster for every movie and sit there and, So what social media, and how do you do it, in which groups?
There is not a receipt, but we work very often with other partners. Of course, we have our only Facebook, and we have the luxury position. We have more than 25,000 people on our Facebook. We have, with music, 45,000 people who get our newsletter, but that's not a guarantee. Often we work together with other organizations who have their audience as well. So it depends on the subject of your program. But I have to be honest, especially with the special screenings, festivals, special events, that's a possibility. But if you get hard film, which is already tough for our own audience, I have to be honest, it's really hard to reach them. And then you get the problem, and you can use every social media you want, but they're not interested. I don't mind they're not interested. That's not my problem. My problem is if they would know where my cinema is. My problem would be if my cinema is not available in the morning for schools. My problem is if they don't come to the events and special screenings. And my hope is, of course, that at a certain moment, 40 plus, that they will come again in the future to my cinema. That is my goal. And I'm very happy with the number of people coming to my cinema, and I think we succeed. But I often have the discussion also in my city, because we have partners in our city too, is should you change your programming? And after long discussions, I don't think that's the answer. The answer is you should be have a profile, be sure about what you want to show, but of course you have to use a range of projects like a shop. It's not only the old-fashioned art house slow movie. Fortunately enough, there is enormous supply of films. We have to make, and I don't know if it's the same in all the countries, but our programmer gets offered about 7-8 films each week. So it's already enormous choice. If you make the choice for this film, you should have all the efforts and do your best to promote it. But it does mean also a lot of films we're not able to show. And, well, that's limitation.
I think there's something really important that you're raising here. And it kind of comes out in your discussion. Some of I think it's a myth that there is a young generation that has some big problem. I remember the 1980s when I was a film student, you couldn't get the film. I was writing about films as a film student, that you were waiting for some little print to come round. I actually think, in lots of ways, the ones that are interested are much, much more engaged than we were. I think the other thing that I think has changed a lot, which I think is really problematic when we're talking about social media, is I was talking, I was on the advisory board, the editorial board of the Europa Cinemas. They have this kind of group of people outside. And one of the things that was a great pleasure was to see people who had been cinema owners for, you know, in the golden eras of the 70s. And you know, they'd done these great things. And we were talking about the 1980s. And they were saying a film like Diva, for example, you may all know Diva, kind of classic movie that. And I was saying, well, you know, how come everyone was into the art house stuff then? You know, you would, and you know, that's a very mainstream kind of art house. There we go, we're already mixing up the terminology. But she said, well, they didn't come. That's in our heads. We think for our generation, we were this much more engaged and we were so much easier to market to. She kept the movie on for an entire year. And she said it took months, this is in Denmark, it took months before people actually started going. But in those days, there was less content around, there was more reason to do it, which maybe feeds into your thing about we don't know how to, we know word of mouth is important, we don't know how to capture it. We put it on one weekend, we do some social media, and then we lose it.
Diva is a very specific case because the film bombed. And then the César came, and he got plenty of César. And then the film started again, and a lot of theaters who had stopped showing it started showing it. The thing is, it would never happen again, because in France we have 18 films a week. We don't know how to do it, and it's like the film is not doing too well. The problem is it's pushing behind, and you have distributors all week long who tell you, well, you got to stop that film. I mean, you got to take mine because the film you have on is not doing well. And it keeps pushing.
No, it's a really important point because I think from a programming perspective, from a timing perspective, from the way that we're doing things, if you've got a massively overcrowded market in terms of films, don't forget, we create these things. We've now got far more films. The economics of distribution has got more and more difficult, which means distributors can't get away with doing a film and putting everything by it a month and then kind of working through. Distribution's got harder. The economics doesn't work. So quite often you'll see things that you might believe in, but they have kind of quite half-hearted kind of pushes. And then you're looking at an opening weekend where how many films in this audience, this is us as the older audience, how many times do you hear someone saying, oh, well, you know, you'll be out for a bite to eat or something, and they'll say, well, I saw this film, it was brilliant. And you think, so you must see it at the cinema, you must go. And then you go to your cinema, it's gone. It's already moved on.
I agree. What you told before, you have a whole day and an evening, which if you start with your programming around 12, it does mean for the elder people or 40 plus people, you have especially the afternoon and for the younger people later in the evening and in the morning when schools. But the problem of we have 5 screens and one concert hall and we have about 24 films every week. I think they changed. But one of the answers, but that's really the future, is that we're experimenting now with a program, because a lot of people just say, listen, I wanted to see this film so badly, but we throw it out after 2 weeks because we didn't have plays, it didn't work enough, whatever. And we give them the opportunity from the beginning, and it's only with a small number of films, because also according to the rights for the films, we show the films also, you can go to our website and see the film and buy a ticket, and you get on VOD the film. It does mean directly at the same period when you start the film in the cinema, you also have the possibility to download it on by VOD. Only these films are only for the period which it's shown in the cinema. So it's an extra possibility, especially for people who don't have the time and complaining, well, there are only 2 screenings in this week to show it. It's bizarre because it's just opposite of what you want as a cinema, because you want to get them to your big screen. But it's a kind of service, it's an extra. And the hope is that they will anyway see that film, know the director, and when the next film is coming, that they're keeping informed about your project. But it's a tough experiment.
It's interesting because there is a huge debate in France about that. It's you know, it's the media chronology, as we call it. And you can't do that. You can't have the film available for download while it's being shown in the theater. You have a few months before it can be available on video, or and if it, there is a pre-sale on TV, it's even further on. So
it's I don't agree completely. I've been a distributor for 20 years. I know how the windows work. But in
it's the law. I'm not saying we shouldn't do it. I'm just saying the law forbids it in France.
But does the law forbids it in France?
Yes.
Because you have
Yes.
Because you have if we buy a film in the Netherlands, of course you get the rights for 10 or 12 years for this film to show it in the Netherlands. Mm. And if you can agree with the producer or the sales agent to get this window out, you're allowed to have VOD. And we already had a few films on VOD in our theaters. I agree for the bigger art house films, and if the producer or sales agent doesn't agree to skip this window, you have a problem. But the law in the Netherlands, as far as I know, because we are doing this already for a few months, but that's how does the law in France forbid to do that? Because in windows is a question of rights.
The philosophy of the thing is that the what has kept the industry alive in France is that we've forced TVs, other people to invest in films in order to have them accept that incitement to buy pre-buy films. We had to say that you had a series of windows that would open and close. I mean, years ago, actually, you were not able to show old films in theaters except in art house theaters. I mean, I'm talking about 60 years ago. Now you pre-finance a film by making a sales to Clear TV or Canal Plus and so on. So Canal Plus is the first one to be able to show it. I think it's 9 months later. Then the Clear TV is 12 months later, and then the DVD and the VOD. You can have a VOD window, I think, 3 months after the release.
Just the windows, as
but
usual.
It's just windows. Yeah. But you cannot. There was an experience because there was a loop in the law, which meant that you could show a film at a theater if it was previously released on VOD. It was a little
bit. But one question, is it really a law? Because I can imagine that Unifrance said, well, we have our windows and we keep to them, and if you want to show the film. But does that also mean for not French films, if the producer or the sales agent agree to skip windows or to skip television, whatever, that they cannot change the windows?
Basically, in theory, films that, for example, has been shown on TV, I cannot release in the theater.
Well, but
afterwards, by law.
In the Netherlands, an enormous amount of small films never reached free TV or whatever. Even DVD is ended, and it's only VOD.
We're going over the windows debate here, and I understand it. And I think those outside France do find the thing quite surprising sometimes. I think that there's two interesting points I think we should just explore here. One is that there is, if you're saying that the program's full, that's it, then I think we may have a problem. But I think that there is, I mean, there were experiments that I think were being done in the States at various cinemas where what you had, what you would try running something where it was consistently repeated. A film that had done quite well would be on a Tuesday night, consistently repeated. And it's funny because actually I'm doing some work with an opera company at the moment who are, their enthusiasm for saying, look, midweek cinema allows us to reach people is so much better than what I'm hearing from film people talking about the same slot. But if what the experiments were then, the landmark stuff, is that you would have over a period of time, maybe some months, so that people knew that for a period you would be able to see this film. So when you told your friends about it, they could keep going. Is that not a viable format for your cinemas to have slots for just films that might keep going for a longer period?
We made a conscious decision not to do that because we offer those slots to young audiences. We do a program called Visible Cinema for deaf and deafened audiences and for people with autism. So we use those slots for those various groups instead. So we take those slots, and they have the same slot every month. So we don't do that very much at GFT, but we do the same thing. We have films for 2 weeks. We also have video on demand immediately. We have our own app. We have our own player as well. So, and we do on day and date films, mostly with Curzon films.
We do that all the time. I kept Timbuktu 18 weeks. I tried, you know, sometimes there are little great film, diamond films that we cannot release on the day it's released over the country, and that we release a couple of weeks later, but we don't have so many more films have come up since that we don't have so many slots, and we try a couple of slots over a long period. We did that with the previous Wiseman movie. We're doing that with Kylie Blues, which is an Asian film, and it does pretty well. What we fail at is keeping the same slot all the time. It's various slot. It's all over the map. But
right. So it's funny you should put your hand up, because I'm just about to come to you, which is in one of the things that is interesting is, could we get the audience, something with this we were going to talk about, could we get the audience more involved in actually making some of those decisions rather than it being top down? So come and grab the mic. Oh, no, there's one there. It's coming. It's on its way.
I'm Marika from Few Cinemas, the Netherlands. I just want to ask you, do you communicate it in upfront that you are having these films for 18 weeks in a row? Because I think that's where the crucial...
I totally agree. I mean, I think the... to put things back in context, it's a theaters that I took over now almost 3 years ago. And I had to discover what type of the audience and so on. So I started with a 1 week program. Now I have a monthly program to help those kind of films.
And you do this together with just a prolongation. So you do the
yes,
two
exactly.
Things.
So, but for example, I don't put the schedule every month out monthly, because I wanted to be able to adjust every week depending on the success or the failure of the films. But I tell everyone in advance which films I will have which week. I don't do yet. I don't say yet how long I'm gonna keep them, because I felt that, you know, I put on the programs that it's going to be the last show, and then I had to change it because usually the last show was very successful, so I had to do another screening. So now I say it might be the last show, and so on. But I think it's the right thing. It's to create to find the right adjustment between create the frustration and announce that it's going to be there for a while. And it's the right balance, very hard. I think the best example for that in France is Utopia. They do, and they do a fantastic job with that. And they created a VOD spot in the theater, which I took also, called Vidéo en Poche. And people come with their USB, and they think. And we thought it would attract younger audience, but actually, it's elder people that come.
No, this is really important. We're talking about people here. When we talk about this, isn't specifically younger people necessarily. Same frustrations are there. I think the argument, though, is that younger people are much more expectant of this kind of things because they're busier.
And just to come back to your bottom-up comment, I really believe that the youngsters should be in charge more. I know that in Watershed they have a youngster
in Bristol,
board.
In the UK.
Yeah, and I think that's very smart, because then you have them in your theater already. And you can start these discussions with them, what they're watching, what they want. And it would be great to have more kind of youngster boards already inside. And I think art houses do have the time and the places to provide that and to get in contact.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Erwin Schmidt. I'm from Berlin. I recently co-founded a startup I'm a producer by trade, but I'm now working on open source prototypes for what we call the cinema of the future. So actually we're looking into how we can create a new cinema going experience. And we conducted a qualitative research. We talked to people across different ages, cinema goers and professionals and cinema people who stopped going to the cinema. And what we realized is, and this is we didn't do a quantitative research, but what we realized by talking to many people is they're looking more for the experience itself mainly than for the specific film. And most cinemas have not done this transition yet of marketing a wholesome experience, so that the marketing for most films still relies on the very product itself. And there are way too many films, and they are cannibalizing each other. And I remember a conversation we had with one young guy in a cinema. He said he has a hard time finding the film because it's just like too many films, and the films don't find him. So, and this is something we had the feeling is the case with many people. They don't really feel addressed. And the bottom line of our research was that people are looking for two things mainly. One is to be part of a community, and one is to be engaged. And most cinemas, from our very personal experience, and we're not talking about yours because you're here because you do something very different and successfully so, but most cinemas don't offer neither a community nor the possibility to engage in whatever way.
I think that's really true. I mean, we started to sell less about the films and more on the ethos. So we are a not-for-profit making educational charity, and so I'm always banging on about that, like, use it or lose it, because if you don't keep giving your money to the multiplexes, we won't be there in the future. We've been there since 1939, and it's our job to make sure that the legacy goes forward. And lots of young people really engage with that in terms of they like the not-for-profit making aspect of our cinema. They like the fact that we have a sustainable green policy. They like the fact that we use local suppliers and make sure that we're giving back to our communities, especially to those poorer areas. And a lot of young people are very engaged with that ethos. And it means that I hope that they will then come and use the cinema. And that's a sort of sense of community, and that's very important. I mean, obviously, I'm like the Scottish Ken Loach here. And Paul Laverty, who wrote I, Daniel Blake's a Friend. So, but yeah, it's it is really important that you make sure that your cinema and that experience, you are part of a community. That experiential stuff as well that you were talking about, people want an experience. We do a lot of that stuff at Glasgow Film Festival, like Connie or a secret location, and those events are nearly always populated by young people, and they want to do something different, and it gives them a route in to your organisation.
But I mean, it's a really, this is a lot of this discussion with Next, as with, and in fact within the film industry, is a lot of this is back to the future stuff. I think we have all these myths around it. When you were, maybe you were all huge cinephiles when you were younger, and your whole lives you've been, you woke up when you were four and said, take me to a Godard movie. Or you might be actually that, like most people, Friday night, we want to go to the cinema. And actually, if you'd got a girlfriend or a boyfriend, the opportunity of being out of the house was actually far more important in lots of ways. The experience you were getting, you didn't necessarily know what was on. I think there's this dream in the heads of when you're at Cannes and you're wandering around and seeing these films and thinking everyone's diarying up. They're looking, I must see that Un Certain Regard thing on the 23rd of whatever. If you're a parent, you know, even if you're a young parent, you are looking at stuff and thinking, I've got to get a babysitter, I've got to do whatever. It's the going out element, and it's the environment in which we're operating that that I think is what you're saying. There are opportunities here to actually understand that it's the place as much as what's actually screening. But that is where perhaps we've got some work to do, yeah, in the art houses as opposed sometimes to multiplexes.
Well, you know, we're talking about millenniums. if we go back to the 80s, there are 36,000 more films available, and most of them are available everywhere on the internet. So the experience is available everywhere. So you're totally right. The experience in the theater has to be different.
Yes.
Otherwise, what's the point? I'm very intrigued why genre films have slowly disappeared. Where they, I mean, for me, for example, I started seeing genre, you know, Wes Craven in multiplexes, which actually gradually brought me to art house theaters on different films, and the genre film is totally neglected by multiplexes, at least in France, and I think, for example, it's a target that students still love, still great fun to see, and it's one of the type of movies that, I mean, I'm thinking of trying to collect to do a rendezvous for it, and I think it's part of the thing, because then, you know, they get to see that, then they see the trailers for the other film, then it's the new experience and so on. But I do agree, it's totally, it has to be, I mean, there are so many films available everywhere, it has to be exceptional somehow.
And it is not. Most times the experience is quite frustrating.
I think the genre thing's a really interesting case, because I think there is that you could argue that it's snobbery. You could argue that it's quality knowing an audience that you've got there. But it seems to me that if you ever go, have you ever been to the Fantasia Film Festival they have in Brussels? And everyone there knows this world inside out, and they're all cheering at the bits that are the kind of coming up. It's hugely energetic, but it's also based on knowledge, because genre for them is not. You can't make a crap genre film and hope to get a genre audience, because they know their market. They talk to each other. They have huge online chat rooms. Work. You've got to be good. I sometimes think, and I hate to say this when I'm at Cannes, because there are wonderful films here made by geniuses, but I sometimes think there's a genre that's here as well, and it's an identikit. It's what I call misery porn. It kind of goes on forever, and as long as it's not a happy ending, and it goes on and on and on and on, and as long as it has very, very long shots, so people look into the distance, and then there's kind of wavy grass. So there is a kind of feeling that, why do we think that someone's going to come in and see that first and want to go on? So why aren't we programming within our cinemas and using the opportunity of saying, come in to watch a genre film, and actually you may find that you've started watching Star Wars, but actually the next thing you know, you start thinking, well, actually sci-fi is interesting. So eventually you find your way to Tarkovsky. Next thing you know, you're looking in the distance at the grass going off. It's the way the world works.
But I think it's a misunderstanding that a lot of young people I meet are really very much aware of what's happening. They have enormous, often surprise about their knowledge about films. But that doesn't mean that they want to see every film in the cinema. And as you said before, they go for the event. And they see enormous amount of films, and they see it everywhere, and they discuss it. And probably more knowledge about what's happening in film than we had in our days, because we had our limited sources. But that doesn't mean they're queuing for going to the cinema, but they're queuing for the event. They want to be part of it.
Can I bring an interesting Tarkovsky point up? Now, look, we're showing they're being reissued in the UK on DCP, and we're showing the whole from Ivan's childhood onwards, et cetera, et cetera. And I looked at the sales figures, and 30% of those tickets are people using the youth loyalty card, which gets them in for £4.50, so they want to see something different because they haven't been around for a while. So your point, they know what they want to see.
I think this is really, I'm going to come to this question here, but I think when we're talking about the atmosphere, young people like my son, who's into art house cinema, have more access than ever before. They are more knowledgeable, far more knowledgeable than ever I was. But there's not one thing called young people. In lots of ways, it's, I think the gender issue and the diversity issue and the youth issue is a class issue. That actually what we're talking about is the sense that at the moment we have what I call the gentrification of culture. I think increasingly you've got a relatively small number of people who are accessing and have better access to things than they've ever had in their entire lives. But actually what you're finding, and it worries me as someone from a poor background, you know, you end up thinking, would I have found my way to art house film now? And I think there's a feeling that we have responsibilities beyond that. But it is a big deal. And I think the place, the research we did in Newcastle was that the place was felt to be intimidating by people from, you know, working class backgrounds. There were a few that said, I don't want to meet my dad in there, which I thought was quite a good reason as well. But there was a feeling that we almost deliberately make them into temples that we don't want to go into. And I think what we're seeing here, actually, cinemas, a lot of the best of the Europa Cinemas members do absolutely amazing things to try and achieve what you're talking about achieving, which is somewhere that feels like it belongs to me, somewhere I want to be. Sorry, you...
Yeah, a few things, because I'm not so sure about the event thing, because I still wonder if it's not a question of education, basically, because I live in Germany, I grew up in France. In France, cinema is the seventh art. In Germany, it's entertainment. It's not regarded as anything more than that. So that's a huge problem. I've had people come in to work for us, and I ask them, what movie do you look? Have you ever seen a French movie? No. What have you seen? Tatort. Tatort is TV crime movies. That's movie for them. So it's pretty scary. So I think I'd like to know if in Europe, if there's if you can see in which countries youth are going more into the movies. And I think France is doing a lot. I don't know if it shows. Because the I see in education, we managed to get in 2 days 205,000 young students, school students in the cinema. And we showed, because what kids want to see is one thing. What the teachers want to show them is another thing. And what the parents want them to see is another thing. So to find the right movie that's interesting, because kids are very interested and they're not fools. So you can show a lot of things that are complex, and they want to see that, and they'll come into the movies and see art house movies, because it's basically you want to see something that moves you and not just entertains
but just,
you.
Just to cut to the chase here, the education, as far as you're concerned, is a critical part of that.
I think it's very important, and I'd like to know in Europe where the differences are.
Okay, well, let's talk about education strategy. Can we just hand the mic over there in a moment. But let's talk about our specifically the work we're doing with schools here. And it is a discussion that the nature of the education we're doing. So in France, there is very much, it's seen as part of the humanities, the arts that you earn as being great work. In other places, there's a sense that actually what we should really be doing is putting cameras in people's hands and saying, go and make something without any of that stuff. But tell us about your own school strategies.
There is a huge system in France which goes from almost kindergarten to high school with different price rates. It's being in danger recently because a lot of regions who co-finance, at least just transportation from the school to the thing, are pulling out to spend the money elsewhere or not to spend the money, whatever. The big question we have is, why is it that this audience that comes every morning, that fills our theaters every morning, never come back? So we wonder whether it's because in their conscience mind, we were forced to come. Liberty Valance is a great film, but why would we come back to the theaters that has shown us Liberty Valance? I'm starting to wonder whether the choice of those films, which are meant to educate their mind to movie, to it's called l'éducation à l'image, are relevant if we want to create a new cinephilia. I think one of the mistakes is probably that we're trying to share our cinephilia, where instead of trying to create a new one, I think, you know, doing that with more recent film, I think would be much more efficient, which could lead us actually to show older film later. But to start with those old films might be a mistake. I don't know. It's it's really interesting. It's like, you know, I get to, you know, you introduce the film, you tell them about the films, you ask them not to stick their gums under the seats and turn off their phones and so on. You ask the parents not to sit in front of the smaller kids.
So you're unconsciously becoming a classroom, is what you're
exactly,
saying.
Exactly.
And film is something that's good for you.
Exactly.
Rather than,
okay. And you ask them, and for them, the theater is not a real theater. The multiplex is still the real theater. I mean, that's my experience.
We have a particular difficulty in Scotland because we have a different curriculum from England. So any national initiatives are slightly different from us because we have a different school curriculum in Scotland. We have about 10,000 school attendees, about 73 performances, but we encounter exactly the same problems as they do in France. It's a forced entry situation. So we've started using a different various school clusters, and we're going out to the schools to talk to them about cinema instead of just bringing them in. So we are doing a two-pronged approach.
Well, education, people always think about younger people, and I think education is something that should continue your whole life. We have three types of what we call education, talent development. The usual part of schools having screenings in the morning, and we advise them by titles. They bring titles, but it's always in the range of our programming. That is very easy to do. Our cleaning lady opens the door for them. They have their spot to find. The other part is we have special programs. For example, we have a special program for young people between 20 and 25. They organize every month their own event. People in Rotterdam can send her films. We call it Opendoek, as it was on the trailer. And there are 25 volunteers with their own community who organize it. What we do is, well, some financial support, but the main support is the availability of the screening room once a month, our marketing tools, and they can use our office and things like that. The third part is, and I think that's also a very important part, because there are also a lot of people who are more deeply interested in film. So give courses for, but also there is enormous demand of people who want to know about more specific things in cinema. And that, to be honest, are often from 30, 35, 40 years old people. But I don't think education is too limited if you think only about classes.
No, and I take the point that you take it out of the classroom structure, but if you create something where your learning can be before the film, it can be after the film, that's how you create the kind of cinephilia we've been talking about.
I forgot one program as well. It's called Watch That Sound. That's for the really younger people, and they make by their own film, and they make their own soundtrack on the film. And they just use our house to do this.
Okay, we're kind of exposing, so we're going to come to another question. We're kind of exposing some fault lines here, which I think is, I didn't say anything about the UK and Europe at the moment, but there is a kind of Anglo-Saxon outlook where I think there's differences with the French view of cinema as being part of that kind of big culture thing. And I'm always aware of Truffaut talking about the cinema de papa. I always think, well, now, I do wonder whether Truffaut is not now the papa, and that we've now not got to the stage where we've kind of got stuck in aspic. But there is that, I just want to, the going out bit is the bit that you're all doing, which I just think is what cinemas right across the Europa Cinemas network are doing, is going out to communities. And when you say, look, our education is not about in the schools and then us hoping to get the benefits from it, it's a kind of permanent means of creating information and engagement. And I think that's a very powerful idea.
Hello, I'm Jane Liscombe. I am British, but I live in Australia, and I did a short film that I invested my entire life saving into, which my father thought was the worst business plan on the planet because he didn't know where my returns were coming from. And I kind of just said it's a moving brochure to hopefully tell people what I can do in the future. And luckily it got into Cannes and won the Palme d'Or, so it was finally I got to prove I had a slight business plan approach. So since then I've gone on to do feature films, and And one recently that I did in Australia called The Mule with Lee Winnell, who did all the Saw movies. We did his debut Australian film, and we tried to basically change the model. And we sort of went for an elevated platform release, you know, to get out there. Because what's happening in Australia is, to get your funding bodies to fund your film, you have to go the old paradigm. You have to get a distributor with money who then says you have to go to a cinema. And the problem is with cinemas in Australia, and I'm hearing it around the world, is they're not experiential. They're not doing what the art world are doing. I mean, I worked with the National Gallery recently in Australia with Ai Weiwei and the Andy Warhol exhibition, and we did a thoughtography where you put a ECG on your brain, you map your brain while you're looking at artwork, and then that artwork gets printed out and you have a thoughtograph. And we kept thinking, really, people want printed things to take away? And they did. We thought they'd share it, or which they did, but they wanted the physical hard copy photo. And so that, my thinking around that has brought me back to the point, and I guess that's a long-winded way of explaining the context of my point, but asking you whether or not it'd be something of interest to you, but I've come up with something due to this next conference, which is called Early Work, where you put together the top or brilliant directors from around the world's early work. So you get the short films, because children, millenniums, have a short form attention span. You know, so it's a 3 minute, or it's a 7 minute, or it's a 15 minute short film. You attach it to potentially, you know, rights films that they own. So then you get them to see these little short films, and that's what brings them in. And the way to package it up is to sort of launch it as one film, almost, with interviews from the filmmakers. And I'm working with Garth Davis, who did Lion. You know, so amazing filmmakers are doing great things out there, both in the art world and the commercial. But it means, to the point of the gentleman from Germany and France, that, you know, some will get to see Steven Spielberg's, hopefully, short films and understand how he got there, and he's commercial. But some might get to see an art house short film that will then lead them to where they can be entertained and belong. So my question was to yourselves was that, is that something, because I'm going to forewall it through TUG at the moment. That's the only model that I'm going to try and look at, because, and launching it through the festivals and trying to do it that way. But is that something like where the, let's say, you know, they have certain cinemas in Australia, they've got UK and they've got Ireland just now. But is that something like France could get involved in, they could network with you to bring you in? It sounds like you're an innovative cinema, and yourselves in Glasgow as well. Like,
so just to be clear, so I'm not sure I entirely understand, but I think what you're talking about here is, again, in order to get people interested more broadly in film, it's actually great as a kind of introductory thing to actually understand how people got to where they got to. So it adds context, which I don't think that's a small thing. I think context is something that I think if you look at people, even my daughter's Game of Thrones obsession, there's that kind of feeling that the thing with Game of Thrones is the whole mythology around it. It's the whole system. If you say you've got an hour and a half and then you can bugger off and go home, there is, what you're saying is there is a potential for actually creating a context and a curation around something which may actually drive other forms of content. Does anyone recognize that kind of idea?
We have done similar things, obviously, with Peter Mullen, because we supported his shorts at their initial stages through Glasgow Film Festival, and then we went on to support his films. But we had a different model in the sense that we showed Peter's shorts, we showed his first Orphans, etc. But then when Magdalene Sisters went on, we were really hoping that that would get into the multiplexes, because you want to just move the filmmakers on as well, so that they also have an opportunity to get to a wider audience. It doesn't mean that they won't come back and make a different, more interesting film. It just means that they will have a wider audience. And I think our job as well as exhibitors is also to make sure that filmmakers have an opportunity to use our venue. And so we've done something similar, and we do a lot of contextual stuff as well. And we also have a short film festival. Although having said that, that is a very young demographic, not necessarily the people that we're trying to get in the cinema, but filmmakers, obviously younger starting off, so.
As I mentioned before, we have our special program every month for young filmmakers, and films can be sent, and we discuss that with professionals. I can imagine from everyone, producers, filmmakers, they all want to have a complete programming, including shorts and stuff like that. For our programming, it's impossible, because with special events, we can arrange something, with Q&As, we can arrange something. But if you want to have your five slots in a day, And it's always very confusing as well, because you go to a film and you see 20 minutes from some short you're not aware. But it's also a very practical thing. First of all, it costs money and it doesn't bring anything. And secondly, for your slots, it makes it too long. So if for example, if you have a slot, that does mean you have only one evening screening. So it's a practical thing. And I think you should more integrated with festivals, events, like your short festival, and just putting 7 or 10 minute films before your film, that's not very easy. For example, our winners from our competition from the monthly short program, we give the few winners in some slots the possibility to show their film. And it's nice because they're also Dutch and often Rotterdam filmmakers who are dying for it to have their short on the big screen.
I do agree it's a practical issue. It's a question of means. In Orléans, we have 3 screens. We release 3 to 4 films every week, and we have between 150 to 200 events throughout the year. I mean, basically 3 events a year at least, a couple of festivals. With the national release of every film, the distributors are entitled to ask for a certain amount of screenings per week. So to fit in everything is very, very hard. And to expect on top of it, the audience to show up is even harder. I mean, I love to show short films, but I don't have the space to show short films longer than 5 minutes, because then it's going to move the entire schedule, and then my last show is going to be at 10 p.m. instead of 9:30, and where I'm going to get a good audience at 9:30, I'll have none at 10. Beside that, we're a small team, and putting that together is just a huge amount of work, but we still think it's a good idea. So we do it through our VOD site. So we have that thing which we did with Utopia, it's called Vidéo en Poche, and basically we release the Jeff Nichols, we have all the Jeff Nichols available for €5. We did that with several other directors. But to give you an idea, for example, there was a great Miguel Gomez film called Redemption, which is a 20 minutes film, which we tried to show with Taboo, which is an hour and 50 minutes film. We couldn't put the two programs together because it was too long. And showing Redemption on a ticket sale, even though we made a really good deal, I think was 150 to see the film. Nobody came.
I think the point you're making here is, all of you, is there are logistical issues, and those logistical issues are getting harder, but maybe that's where VOD and other opportunities come in, that you create the cinema experience around here. And I think VOD and cinemas has been a bit too much seen as we can show the films we're already showing going on. But VOD is actually a much more dynamic. It offers much more opportunities, maybe, for offering context and conversation. So can we take one here first?
Yeah, firstly, I wanted to congratulate you with your choice to release it through Tug, which is basically a bottom-up approach anyway. And there are several initiatives in Europe that are similar. So I'll tell you afterwards. What I wanted to comment on is that you were talking about that you wanted to engage with the millennials we're talking about. And after that, I heard you saying that you wanted to tell them to put off their telephones. And I don't know how you want to communicate with millennials when you let them shut down their phones. I really think that at least the least thing we have to do is Wi-Fi in every cinema and inside the screening hall.
I think one screen is enough. Basically, the story.
Okay.
I don't think people can. Yeah, I directed films before. I think, you know, the amount of money, the amount of energy, I mean, the respect for the work of the directors, is very hard. There was a great experience.
The first reason they leave your venue is because they cannot communicate.
But well, why don't they watch the film?
Before we get into this, there's actually the research is very, very mixed at most. And in fact, for a lot of people, the truth is that I think is more true is that from the research that I was looking at, looked at quite recently, who was by now?
AMC did an experience.
Yeah, but the point was they were saying it may be a reason why people don't go to the cinema is that they don't want to be off the grid. But actually, I've not seen any research anywhere that suggests that they want to watch it during the period of the screening. Which, if that was true, I think there's a discussion. And in the US, there's been experiments. But the idea you have to have two screens on at the same time, I think, is an interesting one. But it's not. I'm not sure it's proven. I'm not sure it's true.
Actually, it's proven that you have more people leaving the theater because too many phones are on than people coming staying in the theater because they can't get access to their phone. I think it's AMC who did the experiment in the U.S. And there was, you know, have it Wi-Fi, phone, texting, and so on. And it's allowed. But actually, it had such a bad effect on the audience that they decided to forbid it. And then the audience went back up. So I don't know. I think it's... Well, maybe it can be special screening. After all, you have you have special screening with subtitles for people who can't hear or and so on. And you have an have a texting screening. It's interesting.
I'm quite interested in the research. I didn't hear about it, but
I think it's AMC. Check it out.
I would leave a screen I would not watch a film. That is affecting other people. That's a different thing. If you turn a screen on and you're sitting next to someone with a screen, they are... Now, I'm not saying that you can say that's why we don't get millennials, but there's actually no evidence that actually they won't want that. Where there is evidence is that Wi-Fi within the structure, which is where your thing comes in. Yeah. If you're leaving a screening, I sometimes think you push them out through the front the door, past the concession stand, and that's the end of your relationship. Whereas I think what you're suggesting, maybe there's screens within cinemas, maybe there's Wi-Fi, there's opportunities there.
Yeah. They were saying there's a direct correlation between tweeting with your stars of your film because it's engaging with the audience. Your community of a film is your community, and then to engage your community, which is your audience, to get them to feel special, you can't take your screening, you know, you can't have Hugo Weaving, which we had, fly to every cinema and with a Q&A. You don't have the money, you don't have the time, they can't fly, carbon offset, I'm a climate person, I don't want to do that. But I can put him in his lounge room in his pajamas and he can tweet with the audience, and you do it at conferences and suddenly you feel engaged. So my thing is, I think it happens at home in television land because you can connect. But what we had is a correlation between our iTunes sales and we had a Twitter party. So we said at 3 p.m. worldwide, push play, get up at, you know, like you do for the World Cup, get up at 3 a.m. with your pizza and your friends, come over, tweet. We'll have Lee Winnell, we'll have Hugo Weaving, we'll have the producers, the cinematographer, you know, have all these people, and you can ask them questions or you can just say funny things.
That's a different thing, and I think it's really interesting. I want to end on that. I just want to take the last question, then because we need to conclude soon, but I actually think you've raised some really important points there that I'd like to come to on the experience. Do you want to make a point?
I think the question is larger than just should we have Wi-Fi in the rooms or not. The question is how can we change the rules of the game and not remain anchored in the past? I mean, if I look around, half the audience in this room, including myself, have been checking emails during this very interesting conference, right? We would not have done that 5 years or 10 years ago. Now we do it because this is how we live, and I think that the risk is that cinemas remain anchored in this cinephile experience that is not appealing anymore for younger people. And I'm not advocating Wi-Fi and texting during the screening. The question is how can we make a more interesting experience? By experience, I don't mean events, but like something that is possible to happen every day, every week, but something that's more than just like, you know, a hermetically closed 90-minute watching... film watching experience.
Well, maybe this is where those two things go together, which is I think the screening thing, I think there is that, I heard exactly the same thing about sport incidentally. There was a long while where people won't want to be at sport, you know, they won't want to go and watch live games, and they did. Yeah, that was old fashioned, it was rubbish, you can't see action replays. I think there are bits of experiences in our lives that don't change. I mean, it's a darkened room, there's stuff going on. I think where you are talking, and I think you're, there are a number of, I mean, Europa Cinemas labs do the most amazing kind of work around what they do when you're inside the cinema, how you create that cinema experience. The cinema experience itself, the watching of the film, though, I think is where I think people would have problems. And I'm not sure, I think my son would have a problem with someone next to them turning on a screen, because it creates a light problem when you're trying to watch the thing in front of you. Where I think you're right and really interesting, and maybe that's where we kind of end up here, is the environment in which we're operating. Because you're talking a bit like the event cinema, the Q&A stuff, you know, Q&A screenings. Of all the research work that we've done on the kind of day and date stuff, day and date doesn't make all that much, you know, it's not brought loads of people in. What has brought people in is a big event. If you bring an event and people get excited about it, you can transmit it by satellite, you can have chats. That's the event, perhaps we could start at the end. That's the bit, that's in your cinema, it's that creation of a feeling that there's a holistic thing. You're going into a cinema that isn't like the old-fashioned thing. You're going in, it might have music there. It may have your means to access tons of stuff that you didn't know you wanted, but you've come out, you're interested, you're following the pattern, the thread, and that needs the Wi-Fi and everything else. Maybe you could just, to finish off, just give us your sense of the experience that really works, that you think is going to excite this demographic group going forward, and where you see any opportunities.
We all use the opportunities that young people are very well aware, because they have the mobile with them. We use it, we want it, because we want to reach them, we want to inform them. But I think, like at a lot of festivals, in the beginning of a film, you have Twitter and on the screen and stuff like that. That's a part of the event, part of the festival. But don't mix it up with sitting next to someone having his mobile on during this beautiful film, because that is not allowed, I think. But you should use it. You should use all the new developments, possibilities of this media, of this, the fact that everybody is available and texting, etc., etc. But just use it in a bright way of all the possibilities.
Okay.
We recently had Richard Linklater come to Glasgow Film Theatre to present Everybody Wants Some. And he came because of Twitter, because 2 years previously we had screened Dazed and Confused in a brewery with a roller disco and created a one-day beer called Richard Drink Later, hashtag drink it now. And he saw that. And so when he was coming from the UK, he said, can I go to Glasgow Film Theatre? We're like, yes. But we do all the same things. It's about, you can, after the screening, the Twitter questions are on there. People can talk to you, him via the Twitter, and also in the cinema as well. So those live events with the actual directors can't replace some experiences. And for us, we want to be the go-to place for those experiences. And even at those experiential Dazed and Confused in the roller disco, people were not tweeting during it because they were having too much fun to do that. So, I think you just got to take each thing as it comes and see how you can use it and you know, as part of the Europa network, and use those innovations that we've learned and stolen those ideas from other great cinemas.
I don't have much to add to that. Now, I think, they launched in France a study on the cinemas of tomorrow. And I had discussion of other friends and so on. And says, what are they talking about? We're already making the theater of tomorrow. That's what we keep doing every day. I mean, we keep wondering every day, how can we do it? You know, how can we renew the experience? And, you know, instead of, well.
And I think that just as an advert, Europa Cinemas, one of the things that, apart from the labs they're doing, I think there's now an innovation survey work that's going on as well. So there actually is now a direct idea that, I think this is the problem. Your local cinemas are sometimes, you know, some of the people on the panel here are doing wonderful things, but there will be, it's not uniform everywhere. The idea is if you can share more of these things. I think the Richard Linklater is a brilliant example of, I think what you're saying here isn't necessarily having your phone. And what you're really saying is it's got to stop being the po-faced 60-somethings, because most of us, when we went there, we went to those cinemas and became big fans in our 20s, and we didn't stop going. And now we are the cantankerous old sods that we didn't like when we were in our 20s. But it didn't mean we weren't lovers of film. It didn't mean we didn't want all this stuff here. What we don't want is the feeling that we're not welcome, that we're not, that it, there's no interest, that somehow you can't have fun, that it's always a temple, it's a classroom, it's a place where you should go and appreciate what we say. And I think what's significant, I think, about the innovations that have come through today, because I realise I need to sum up, because we're out of time. But I think that what we're saying here is that we've got to listen. We've got to get into the conversation. But the conversation is not one that we should assume is the one we think. That's not just choosing the right social media here. It's not assuming that young people talk in a certain way and that they're only interested in talking about this, or they're not interested in the kind of films that... you just got to speak. Allow some input. Allow it to be interactive rather than treating them as passive audiences. And I think we heard some really great opportunities here. I think the lifestyle approach, which is how do we get into the lifestyle of the demographic groups we want, I think is more challenging for reasons that aren't necessarily in our control. I think particularly the number of films that are going on makes it more difficult. And distributors want their slot, but that slot, the exploitation window, is horribly, horribly small at the moment. I think there's actually quite sincere dangers in us allowing ourselves to be a world in which all so much content is happening that we end up with just it just stops being interesting. It becomes something where we never build word of mouth. You can never allow the conversation to go on. So what we've heard here is there's the possibility of programming changes in terms of when we put things on. And I think, again, listening to who that audience is, letting them have a say about when they would want to watch it, is what our cinemas are doing here. I do take the point that's coming here now from Jane, this idea that actually, if we understood what they wanted, it may not be what we think they want. Maybe actually it's a deeper engagement, not a lesser engagement. It's not we want to offer a more shallow experience. Maybe what we want to offer is more depth of experience. And that might mean by making the places we're at a bit like the equivalent when you're online. I think this is one of the things that's changed for younger audiences, but it's changed for all of us, is the way that we interact with content online has changed. So you start reading one thing and you're clicking through and you're linking to something else. Next thing you know, you're looking at something and you've wasted your whole day, and that's just for self-employed people. It's the worst thing in the world that ever happened, because you forgot what you started out doing. But the point is, there is a flow. Cinemas, the physical space, can be brilliant places where that kind of links, those bringing together those links, can work. And I think, again, we're hearing initiatives and ideas that can work here. I think the content is the discussion that we're all having, is what is the nature of the content that we're bringing in. I do love the fact that Glasgow are doing these things, and I do love the fact when lots of cinemas are saying, what about if we get people to make things? What if we actually get them directly involved so they can see the work they do as being part of the context? It's their culture, their filmmaking. And I think that for the first time in history, we've all got access to cameras and the means of distribution and the means of marketing. For the first time ever, why won't cinemas capture that? And I think that's something that's good, because I think if we start thinking what they want is minions as the end rather than as a mechanism that can get them interested, then I think we have a slippery slope to a world in which it's just going to stop being interesting for anybody. So all the diversity, all these ideas, I think we're beginning to see from the cinemas here. We're hearing about how they're going to be shared. I think the thing that comes across to me out of this is the thing that's broken and changed about this debate in the last 5 years is that the assumption I used to hear over and over again is the 20th century art form, the cinema, the physical space, who the hell is going to go to that? And I think it's a bit of an echo, actually, should we have our mobile phones on? when you hear the head of production of Amazon telling you that he sees cinema as the absolutely critical means of creating the demand that they're going to exploit, he sees that when they make a film, they want it in cinemas. I think that the physical space, just in a world in which we're more and more overcrowded with people, it's not just our film programs. Our towns and cities are growing exponentially. We're seeing less and less. Privacy is becoming less and less of a thing. It's so more and more difficult to get away and find your own space. Cinemas still offer that experience where you are in a physical space and you're interacting with content in a way that doesn't tie you down to all the kind of noise and mess that's going on around you. So one way or another, I think what we've got here is a world in which the potential for innovation and the potential for using those social spaces is going to be what drives cinema for the next few years. And I think our future, to me, depends on it. So we've just got to go. I'm really sorry. Did you have a point you wanted to shout out?
Yeah, I just wanted to share something.
Oh, no, sorry. I'm being told to shut up. You can share it with everyone. You have a gentleman here in the corner.